Victoria's News Authority, CFAX 1070.
Hi, it's Bruce Williams on CFAX 1070. A rainy day. It's that time of year. Speaking of the weather in that time of year, there's something going on Vancouver Island that hasn't really happened much before, if at all. You may have seen this story on CTV News from the Comox Valley with our Gord Kerbis, who did a story about this. People that are animal rehab people, are starting to see snowy owls, those beautiful, magnificent, lovely white owls that aren't supposed to be here. And a lot of the ones that are showing up are appearing at a facility in the Comox Valley called the Mountain Air Avian Rescue Society. And Maj Birch is the woman who operates that, and she's on the line now from downtown Merville. Hey, Maj, how are you?
Hi, Bruce. I'm good. Thank you.
So why are there snowy owls all of a sudden on Vancouver Island?
Well, every year there's what we call an eruption of snowy owls. And so these are young of the year snowies that have to leave their nesting area, and they move further south trying to establish territories.
Now, where are they normally found?
Normally they're up in the Arctic and the tundra.
Okay.
Now, these owls, some years there are more than others. Last year, Vancouver Island did not see very many snowy owls, but there was a huge eruption, which encompassed a large portion of North America, down as far south even as Kansas.
Really?
And in that area. And so there were all kinds of birds that were seen the last year. Vancouver Island, we didn't really see that many. We did have one that we released and one that came into our center, but the majority of them were more located over in the mainland.
Hmm. Okay, so in general, why don't they come here?
Why don't they come here? What we would see normally is that, you know, there's not a large population of these owls, and they respond to producing more young when there's more food available.
So we don't have the food here that's their normal food source, is that, or is it just too warm here?
Well, definitely that. These are truly an Arctic bird, and they're very much adapted to that environment. They nest on the ground. Their primary food source is lemmings. And so, of course, the lemming population will rise and fall and fluctuate, which is a normal cycle.
Mm-hmm.
And as the large number of lemmings are available, then they will produce more offspring, or they'll have a number of offspring that will survive, right, because there's more food available to them.
Okay. I would imagine that I could be wrong on this because I'm wrong a lot, but ground nesting birds probably have a less chance of survival on the island than they would in the Arctic.
Well, certainly we don't have the same environment that snowies are used to in the Arctic. So where you would find them would be wide open areas along farm pastures, along beaches. Airports seem to be a very popular location for these birds.
Hmm.
Because it's wide open, and they tend to like to sit up a little bit so they can see around and survey their area.
Yeah, they're quite beautiful, aren't they?
Oh, they're gorgeous. And the males will be a little bit more white on them than the females, but the juveniles tend to have quite a bit more flecking in their plumage than when they're mature. So what we're seeing here now are the immature birds that were hatched this year.
Okay. They're really white.
They're very white, yes. And so they also are subject to being harassed by crows and ravens. So oftentimes you'll see those birds flocking after them and pestering them. They have a natural enmity with owls. And so you'll often see them. But these are a large owl. They're one of Canada's largest owls. They actually are closely related to the great horned owls.
Hmm.
So very fierce and ferocious, and very few predators, from the bird world.
In their natural environment, anyway.
That's right.
Yeah. So you, just your facility, we'll go back to that for a second here. The folks down here would know Wild Ark. But you're somewhat similar to that. You take care of and you rehabilitate wildlife injured by whatever means may have hurt them. That's what
yes,
you do.
That's right.
So,
so we've had a few phone calls this year about snowy owls.
Okay. Now, What kind of shape are they in when they come to you now, these snowy owls?
Generally, they're starving to death. When you consider that they've had to migrate all the way from the Arctic, may not have had enough food up there, so they're moving further south into unknown territory, not as familiar. The lemmings, of course, don't occur here, so they have to find new foods. They'll hunt ducks, they'll hunt hares, but their primary sources is mice. This year is a good year for, you know, there being an abundance of mice in this area.
Yeah. What else is going on at this time of year? I mean, the snowy owls are, I guess, somewhat of an exception, but what, this time of year, what comes in to see you? What are you taking care of?
Well, we picked up a trumpeter swan yesterday, so young trumpeters, again, migrating for the first time. They're under considerable stress. They become weakened from the long migration. Again, these are birds that live in the Arctic or tundra from Alaska, and as they migrate south, they become weaker and weaker. Sometimes they have a large parasite load.
Oh, where was this one? Where did this come from?
The trumpeter swan?
Yeah, where was it found?
Well, here in the Comox Valley, we have a very large population this year, larger than normal. We've been counting trumpeter swans. I've been counting for over 20 years now. And so this year we've got 2,200 swans about in the valley, which is a large number for this time of year.
Wow.
And so this one was found just standing on a road in a nearby field.
So you fix them up and you release them again?
Well, yeah, we try to. This one is young, and they are, of course, have a separation anxiety from their parents.
Usually
spend the whole year with their parents. And so the parents provide some protection for these young swans. So.
Where do you get the support for doing what you do? Where do you get the money from to do this?
Well, we depend, of course, on donations. We receive grants from various sources, gaming grants in the past, and also, you know, from corporations to build many of our facilities. We have, BC Hydro has been big in supporting us in the past.
Well, you have a website.
We do, and that's wingtips.org.
Wingtips, as in birdwingtips.org.
That's right.
Merville, we'll mention, is where you are, which is just north of Comox on the way to Campbell River on the old highway.
And upcoming this weekend, we've got an open house from 1 to 4 p.m. after the Merville Craft Hall, a craft show. So we will be attending there with our ambassador birds. We invite the public to come and meet our ambassadors and have a cup of cider.
So an ambassador bird is a bird that comes with you and is perched on your arm, I think.
That's right. These ambassadors give people an opportunity to meet some of these wild birds and get up close, and they learn about why these birds are in our care and not back in the wild.
Yeah, which if you've never seen one of these creatures up close, oh boy. It would change your life if you do for the first time. Maj, thanks for taking the time to speak with us today.
Thank you, Bruce, and I hope everyone will vote for us on our webpage. We have voting to help us raise more funds.
Oh, okay, wingtips.org. Go on there. Vote. Make it happen. Vote often.
Thank you.
Thea, thanks. Maj Birch from the Mountain Air Avian Rescue, which is located in Merville in the Comox Valley.